This is the Chris Vernon Show podcast.
Here we go. Welcome to another edition of the Chris Vernon Show podcast. Today on the podcast, we are going to do 10 things on this Thursday, including the upcoming football weekends, the Memphis story, both football and basketball, that are going on, a couple NFL notes, and all the big stories of the day. Yesterday was really fun. I hope that those of you that have not already, go back and check out Vince Hunter, who is a new member of the Memphis Grizzlies. He's going to be assigned a two-way deal with the Grizzlies and the Memphis Hustle, so he will be toggling back and forth this upcoming year. But we talked to him for a long time yesterday about his life, his career up to this point, and he is certainly a guy that is happy about his plight in life, and signing that deal was a dream come true. You know, a lot of these guys, he had played in Russia, he had played in Greece, he had played in the D League, and so he's just fighting and fighting and fighting, believing in a dream that he would, you know, have the opportunity to wear an NBA uniform one day. And so, at least in a small way, it has certainly, he's validated for what he's gone through. Really like the guy. Really like the guy, and excited to see what he does this upcoming year. For if he can contribute to the Grizzlies, and certainly will be one of the big players for the new G League team, the Memphis Hustle, this year. We're going to get to the 10 things. First, I'll welcome John Roser to the show. John Roser, a.k.a. the Cologne Ranger, a.k.a. the Body Spray Bandit, a.k.a. Senior Sack, a.k.a. Johnny Backhole, Johnny Bearcat, a.k.a. John Snozer, the Grim Roser, a.k.a. John Zimmer, Johnny Hustle, a.k.a. Red Roser, Red Roser, send Johnny on over, a.k.a. Run, Dumplin', Run.
What up? What up? What up? What up?
I really liked Vince Hunter.
He was awesome. And those UTEP fans are serious, man.
Is that right?
They got a hold of my retweet of you yesterday. I woke up this morning.
About the show?
Like, yeah. I was like, because I said, you know, he talks about playing for Tim Floyd.
Oh, yeah. So they found it, huh?
Yeah, a couple UTEP fan blogs, which I didn't know existed. But they have some. And I think, like, one of their assistant basketball coaches, like, retweeted it or favored it or something, liked it or whatever it's called now.
There you go.
Gave it a heart on Twitter. Yeah, so these UTEP fans are serious.
How about that? All right.
So, shout out to Tim Hardaway, too, UTEP.
Yeah, Tim Hardaway. Shout out to Tim Hardaway for sure. And Arnett Poultry, for that matter.
Yes.
For that matter, Memphis. His kid and played down at UTEP.
Tony Barbie.
Yeah, shout out to Tony Barbie also, and Don Haskins for that matter.
Yeah. And might as well Dan Wetzel, since he wrote the book.
Who wrote Glory Road years ago. So anyway, really liked Vince Hunter, excited about him and this upcoming season. Last night was another non-football night, as I said yesterday, going through a Tuesday and then a Wednesday. And figuring out, okay, like, what's going on? I end up reading a bunch of stuff. And I will tell you, a little update here. The phone rang, and I looked down at my phone, and it was one number 9, Tony Allen.
Oh, yeah.
Who I had not heard from. I think he thought I was going to be mad at him about the story. It was very strange because he's like, hey, man, he's like, my bad on signing with the Pelicans. He's like, that all happened so fast. And then, like, I guess that.
Yeah.
And I was like, I couldn't care less. I was mad about it anyway. Right? And so, I mean, there's a couple of things, right? He's just hurt, right?
Yeah,
he's,
of course.
He's a hurt guy. He really wanted to stay in Memphis. You know, listen, the Grizzlies had offered Tony an extension during the year and was going to play it out, right, and see what happened. And obviously, it just didn't go the way, right, for the Grizzlies or for him at the end. And so, you know, there's hurt feelings, right, that goes on, whatever. But,
you know, one of the things that I just attempted to say was like, hey, man, look, whatever you do, don't turn on the Grizzlies, the franchise, all that kind of stuff because of something like this. Because you never know the way this stuff is going to play out. And I said, and you ain't going to have that long of a career, and you're going to come back here, and you're going to be a hero forever. And so, like, don't run and jump on a microphone and tell people, right, like, you know, bashing, whatever.
Right.
You know, keep that relationship good. I was like, because, I mean, hell, they'll be honoring you in the first game. And he was like, what? He had no idea that they opened with the Grizzlies.
He had no clue that they open in FedEx Forum.
Bro, I don't even think he knows who he's playing for next
year.
Yeah,
that's true.
Except for the fact that he did tell me, he was like, you know, he's like, with Boogie in the brow, and he's like my guy Rondo's there.
Yeah,
you know. So I mean, he's like that's kind of, you know, it'd be exciting. It'd be different. Whatever.
Yeah. Got a chance to play in the playoffs. Yeah, they could make the playoffs, and obviously
Z-Bo is somewhere else. Whatever. But I mean, he's just like anybody else, right? Like, I mean. You wish it could work out, right?
Yeah.
And so, on one hand, right, it's all so fresh right now, but that was not my only words of advice, right? And like for years, obviously we've talked, and I'm not speaking out of school here. Like whether it was, you know, being mad about Lionel Hollins or being mad about Dave Yeager or being mad about whoever over the years, you know, I always attempted to play the role of, hey man, just don't, right? Like, I know your general inclination. And so on this one, I was just like, hey, you'll be a hero here forever. And you got to remember, no matter who you're mad at right now, I was like, there are hundreds of thousands of people that swear by you and love you.
Yeah.
And will wear your stuff forever. And so don't alienate them, right? You got way too many people that love you, right, for this to turn sour.
All
you
would have to do is just go to Twitter and search his name, and you see what all the Grizzlies fans said when they found out he was not here. I mean, it was...
And then he got a little wistful talking about, you know, things over the years or whatever else. And so, obviously, you do that, right?
Yeah.
It's got some level of reflection now that it's reality that it was done.
I hope he wears 42 in New Orleans.
Oh, that'd be interesting.
Because he wore, 24 at Oklahoma State. He wore 42...
Yep.
In Boston. So number 9 would be the only, if he wears a different number, if he wears like 42 or 24 in New Orleans, and that means that number 9 would be, this Memphis would be the only place he's worn it.
Yeah, so
it's his choice. He can wear whatever he wants.
It's all going to work out.
Here's a good thing. Rondo wears 9.
Oh, yeah.
Rondo wears number 9.
Oh, well, and here's another thing, Roser. Well, another thing is, you never know.
You could play
out this year and next year be back.
Absolutely.
To end the career, right?
Yeah, you're only on a – it's not like you signed a 3-year deal.
No,
you never know the 1-year deal.
Right? You never know the way the stuff's all going to play out. And so that might be so, right?
Yeah.
Where you do your swan song, you actually do retire in a Grizzlies uniform. Like, that possibility is still out there.
Because it's not
there.
Like Tony – unless barring a catastrophic injury, Tony's not going to be done after this year.
And you know as well as I do, like – everything seems like it's going to last for a long time, but I mean, we may look up and Fizdale might not be the coach. Like, you just don't know. You change coaches, you change GMs, you change ownership. We've been through all of it, right? So it's one of those you just never know, right? But anyway, he seemed to be in really good spirits, and then he said he was in California, and I didn't ask why. He's in California.
Well, a lot of NBA players are out. A lot of them stay out in California.
You know who he goes out there to hang out with is Pierce.
Okay.
Still big buddies with Pierce.
I said he could have been out there with Z-Bo. Maybe. I was Zach.
Yeah, still big buddies with Pierce, though.
Yeah.
I know.
Well, he always talked about how much he looked up to Paul Pierce and how much Paul Pierce helped him along.
Yes. And so, anyways, first time I had spoken to him since all of this stuff went down. And, you know, it is what it is, right? I mean, he's going to be playing for New Orleans. He seemed fine with that, right? Though he did want to be here. But I just said, whoever you're mad about for this not working out, like, just be mad at that person, but don't be mad at everything, and don't slip up or say something that you want to take back one day, right? Because I've been there on a smaller level, and I just think that, you know, you got to realize how many people are hurt and, you know, and did want you back and do, right? And spent a lot of time loving you.
Yes.
So don't, you know what I mean? Like, sometimes it can end badly. I mean, I saw what happened with Rudy. I saw it. You know what I mean? He got the chance to talk about it in Toronto, and he's like, you know, when they ask him, what do you miss about Memphis? And he's like, I don't miss anything, nothing. And everybody was like, damn, man.
Yeah.
And then it was like, DeMar DeRozan's the best two guard I ever played with. And, you know, he would like, it just kind of, like when the stuff would come up, it would be like, you know, I mean, screw this guy. Remember when Lionel left and it was like, it's like a third world country or whatever. They don't even have the internet type of stuff. Remember?
Yeah.
And the people, and you know, some people just blew it off. It was like, no big deal. But then like there was a column written about it. Like, you just want to be careful. I've seen it too many times. And I hope with him and Zach, it would be a tragedy, man, if they like, if whatever they're,
well, Zach
just
won't.
Because you're, I get it, but because you're hurt about things, listen, Zach, Tony, and Vince all wanted to be here. Just did. Yeah. And that's the way sometimes it goes in professional sport,
well,
right?
Well, Zach, the thing with Zach, why Zach won't is, like, you only hear Zach talk bad about Portland.
I get it, but you just, listen, Rose, Zach know.
Well, here's, Zach lives here.
So does Tony.
Exactly.
I saw Vince at Raw two weeks ago.
But this is what I'm saying. When their careers are done, Vince Carter's not going to live in Memphis.
He could work for the Grizzlies, though. That's not crazy.
No, that's not crazy. But I'm just saying.
And
like,
those other two could be brand ambassadors.
No. But that, right? But I'm saying even if, like, okay, let's just say when they're retired and they're not going to do anything. They're just going to retire off into the sunset. Vince Carter's not living in Memphis. Tony Allen and Zach Randolph will probably. Zach Randolph will for sure. They will live in Memphis.
I get it, but you know this, Roser. I know these guys. And the microphone will be in their face at the wrong time at some point when they're feeling some kind of way.
Yeah.
And all I would say was just be careful about this. Don't make Memphis mad because you're dealing with a lot of people that love you.
Yeah.
And so you can't throw in whoever you're mad at. Don't throw that in the bucket of Memphis because that ain't the bucket of Memphis, right?
Yeah.
Because that can happen because what you're thinking in your head is screw that guy, screw this, screw that, whatever, right?
Yeah. Like
that's what's running through your head, the anger part, right? And so then it comes out wrong, right? Like you know what I mean? And then you start saying something that you don't mean. You're not necessarily just aiming it at whoever you're upset about and not working out, right?
Yeah.
Because it's all fresh. So I was like, that was my only thing, right? And I hope that's true with him and Zach and Vince and everybody else. The last thing on earth, it would break my heart to see a quote from one of them that was unflattering of Memphis.
Well, I would think they have already told Zach and they announced it publicly. They are retiring his number.
I know.
Like,
yeah.
So they've already, they have told Zach, like, look, man, like, yeah, it didn't turn out the way you wanted. We know.
But I'm just saying sometimes you can confuse your job or whatever, it didn't work out with the city or the organization, right? That is not the organization. That is a person or people, right, that you're upset that it didn't work out, right? We didn't have any say in it.
Yeah.
If I had any say in it, you'd be playing, right?
Absolutely.
We didn't have any say in it. Other people did.
Yep.
All right. So I do want to remind you that there's a bunch of these concerts coming up, right? You got Bruno Mars coming up this weekend.
Which,
Janet
by
Jackson.
The way, Bruno Mars is a stone-cold sellout from what we've been told. Like, it is a hard set. Like, there is not a ticket left in that place.
Janet Jackson's going to be here, but also the Foo Fighters are going to be here October 24th, a little over a month away, on a Tuesday night. It's the Concrete and Gold Tour. Tickets for the concert are on sale now at Ticketmaster.com or by phone, 800-745-3000, or the FedEx Forum box office. In addition to that, I want to remind you that if you need to sell a house in Memphis, make sure you go with Jennifer Carstensen and the RE/MAX Real Estate Experts at the Live Love Memphis Group. They may already have your buyer. You can contact them for a list of families actively looking for properties who haven't been able to find a match. The Live Love Memphis Group. Jennifer Carstensen is her name. She's the best in Memphis. They sold over 165 houses last year. They've already sold over 100 this year with over 35 pending right now. If you need to sell a house, there's only one person. They sell them for the most money and they sell them quickly. Jennifer Carstensen, RE/MAX Real Estate Experts, the Live Love Memphis Group. Find them online, livelovememphishomes.com, livelovememphishomes.com.
You mentioned that Foo Fighters show. Album out tomorrow.
The Foos?
Album out tomorrow.
Huh.
Yeah. New album, Concrete and Gold will be out tomorrow.
That's the name of the album.
I believe
Not just
so.
The name
yeah.
of the tour?
Yeah, I think I believe it's the name of the album, too. It'll be out tomorrow, though.
One of the great.
And Justin Timberlake will be on that.
I think one of the great remaining rock bands that like, are still like really
the,
relevant.
Like the only one.
There's very few.
Them and Pearl Jam.
Pearl Jam.
Yeah.
Kings of Leon still does good.
Yeah. Kings of Leon does.
Kings of Leon does good. And there's a couple others.
Yeah.
Red
Hot Chili Peppers, they still do well when they tour around. Yeah.
They got a lot of good songs, man, and they are he is amazing at concert. I've seen him before.
I've seen him three times. Yeah.
The Foos?
Seen the Foos three times.
All right, let's get to 10 things.
10 things, 10 things, 10 things, 10 things, 10 things, 10 things.
All right, number 10, Vince Hunter. I did want to comment on this. For those of you that didn't get to hear it, go back to yesterday's podcast and check them out. We did a get to know. Vince Hunter signed a deal earlier this week, and I think people were like, what? Right? They already got too many players. But they wanted to give Vince Hunter one of the two-way deals. Think that he is a guy that they really want in the organization that could feasibly help, obviously, the G League team in a big way, and then possibly help the Grizzlies at some point. He's got a great story. He is a super nice guy, and I think there's just no way you're not going to – I think if you listen to that interview, you're going to want to root for him like hell. You really are.
Yeah.
Because he's a great story, and he is as humble as can be, and he is – he's one of those – pinch me guys, right?
Yeah.
Like this is so awesome, right? That this is all happening. And so I love it for guys like that. He has no fanfare for that matter. He's a kid that grew up dreaming of getting to play in the NBA, and he has done everything he can to try to get there.
Yep.
And it's worked out for him, right?
Yep.
He's gonna get that opportunity. And so anyway, really likable guy. And I think you will, hopefully, through the course of the interview, really get to know him and kind of know what he's about. And then you will have some kind of personal investment in him and his success.
Yeah.
Whether it's with the Hustle or it is with the Grizzlies. Number 9, want to get this out of the way. Yesterday we mentioned the John Jones thing. The UFC did strip him of the belt. And they gave it to Daniel Cormier, which is always a extremely weird deal. Like they, you know, of course they named the fight a no contest, right? So the history books will show it as a no contest. But anybody that watched that knows John Jones beat him, right? And so it's always a weird spot, right? It feels like if they said Hank Aaron hit the most home runs ever. I'm like, what? I'm like, no, he didn't.
Yeah,
like,
no,
you know,
he didn't.
Like, Barry Bonds, okay, it's messed up that he, you know, that Barry Bonds, right, was hitting balls into an ocean and turned into this Greek god.
Well, it's like Giancarlo Stanton who says that he believes the real home run record is Roger Maris at 61.
Yeah.
It's like, yeah, well, no, it's not.
Yeah, no, it's not. Right? This happened.
Yeah.
So it's always a weird deal, right, where it's like, okay, I really resent and hate that about the whole the drug thing, the performance enhancing drugs. If it's against the rules and you're doing it and the other guy is clean, right?
Yeah.
Because now you've screwed this up.
Yeah.
Because I saw Daniel Cormier get his ass beat. Like, I saw that. Right? So don't keep telling me he's undisputed and he's the greatest. And maybe you are the greatest. But you're not so great that you can beat guys that are roided up.
Right. Why wouldn't they just take the belt and just have it up for grabs and have whoever the number? Because they do rank them by contenders, right? Why not just have the number one, number two contenders fight for it?
Well, the other thing that's because it was Cormier's before.
Right.
It was his. Okay, here's the other thing that's messed up. It's like Brock Lesnar and Chael Sonnen and like everybody's gotten popped.
Yeah.
Anderson Silva, when Anderson Silva got popped, that's, you know, because I love him. I worshipped him. My favorite fighter ever. When he got popped, I was like, okay. Like, dude, look at him. He has, like, no muscle definition. He's just this amazing, you know, Brazilian jiu-jitsu artist, and he has, like, no muscle definition. And what, like, if he's on, if he is not, it, like, okay, you see Brock Lesnar, it's like, oh my God. Okay, that's probably not natural, right?
No way.
And I'll tell you, John Jones did not look unnatural to me in the fight. He did not. You didn't look at him and go, wow, that's crazy.
Yeah.
Right? like you do some guys.
Well, I mean, Conor McGregor is another one. Yeah. I mean,
he didn't like it, though.
When he, you know, but what was the fight? He had to go and put on like 15 or 20 pounds to fight Diaz or one of those guys.
Yeah, it was a catch weight.
But he wouldn't come back to America. He just stayed over in Ireland.
Right.
He would not come back to America to
promote. You never know with
these
guys.
He stayed over in Ireland, and it's like,
right, for the press conference and stuff, because I think they probably thought they're, if you're going to drug test me, you got to go find me all the way over here.
Yeah.
All right. So, anyways, John Jones done, and now we'll just await a suspension possibly next. Number eight, Memphis and Central Florida are working on buyouts of their games in a couple of weeks.
Yeah, I think it is. It's almost done.
Okay. Like
it's going to happen.
Commercial Appeal had a full story about this, saying that there is a date that is just a few weeks away, where Memphis is scheduled to play against Georgia State and Central Florida is scheduled to play against Maine, and that they would make it up that weekend in Orlando. And according to the copy of their home-and-home agreement with Georgia State that the Commercial Appeal got through the public records request, such a change would trigger a $800,000 cancellation fee in addition to the expenses incurred by the home team if ever. But they said such costs could be covered by the conference. I will tell you that if that was not going to be covered by the conference so that they could get that done, there is no way in hell Memphis can afford to pay $800,000.
You do not pay $800,000.
Some schools can.
Yeah, no.
You
some
know what I mean?
Schools
like,
can.
They just say, well, what the hell?
Yeah.
Right?
If you're Florida State, we'll make it back. You can afford it. Like, whatever.
We'll make it. Well, the other thing is you certainly don't pay $800,000 for a friggin' road game.
No.
You got no chance of making money back, right?
Yeah.
You got no chance of making money back.
You would imagine the conference would pay that.
Anyway, the Orlando Sentinel on the other end of this report says it is highly likely that that's going to happen. So that's great. It's another great game.
It is.
For sure, right? And it also is, that would put them even with everybody else in terms of conference games, which is what you want. Because that was going to cause quite a conundrum if those two teams, who are supposed to be two of the best teams in the league, played less games than everybody else.
Yeah.
Right? I mean, you get in a weird spot there. Because, maybe they do. Maybe they haven't. I mean, the team that's taken a loss or two losses, we played more games. That's not fair, right? Like, you know what I mean? Maybe you would have lost if you would have played. Like, you don't get credit. So it just causes a lot of problems if you don't have the same amount of games as everybody else. But glad they are getting that done. Six? Yes. Seven.
Seven.
Deshaun Watson is starting for sure. I was happy about that just because it makes it a lot more entertaining. That game's tonight, too, right?
Yeah, it is tonight. Texans and Bengals tonight is the Thursday night game. Yeah.
Hey, let me give you another little one on tonight then. You know what else is happening tonight?
Boise State's playing.
No. I'm talking about in that particular game. Obviously, I want to see Deshaun Watson. There is another rookie that I really want to see in that game. I saw a report this morning that for the Bengals,
John Ross
is going to be playing.
Yeah,
he is active.
Who broke the forty record?
Ran a 4.22. And here's the thing, Roser. Okay, so let's just say that if you are a guy that can legitimately run that fast, which he did it, right? He can't. He is that fast. Okay, so if you're that fast, what are you going to have to do to deal with this guy? You are going to have safety help.
Mm-hmm.
When you have Tyler Eifert and you have A.J. Green, there ain't enough safeties to go around.
Yeah.
And so I could see this guy doing big things.
Yeah.
Big things. I used to see this years ago. Obviously, my favorite team of all time was those mid-90s Cowboys.
Yeah.
And the kid that was from Tennessee, Alvin Harper, he was on that other side from Michael Irvin. And you would see Aikman could just drop back, and he would just chuck it. And there's one guy to beat, right? Because the other ones, you got to worry about Alvin Harper, and you got to worry about Michael Irvin, and you had to worry about Jay Novacek, and you also had these safeties cheating because you may just hand it off to Emmett on a 3rd and 6, right? Like, you just caused all kinds of problems for these guys. But I'm telling you, if you've got a guy that can run like that, and in Harper's case, he could run and jump, right? So, and you don't have two guys, you don't have another guy that can help, if he just runs past me, you got trouble, baby.
Yeah.
So I'm excited. The only thing about it is that Andy Dalton is his quarterback, so that's a little and their offensive line is absolute trash.
Yeah, because
you got to have time for John Ross to get down the field.
Because I remember a guy who got drafted really high in the NFL draft who was like this huge speedster, and he turned out to never do anything in his career. His name was Darius Hayward Bay.
Still got a career.
He was super.
He was not what he was supposed to be.
He was like a freaking top seven pick in the draft.
It was also a massive reach.
It was. It was a reach. Because Mike Crabtree was supposed to be the best receiver in the
everybody
draft.
Laughed
yeah.
and said that Darius Hayward Bay, that is just Al Davis and his stopwatch.
Yeah.
Al Davis just did that every year.
Yeah, he just took the fastest guys.
Right. Oh, like, what's the guy's name? James Jett or whatever. Like he just,
yeah.
You know, he had that one little moment where he was like, oh, to hell with it. Just get the oldest guys. And so he had Tim Brown and Jerry Rice. And he made the damn Super Bowl. He made the Super Bowl yeah. with those two guys, right?
And Rich Gannon, old-ass Rich Gannon.
Yeah. All right. So now we are due number six. Which is so that John Ross, who we talked about, was one of those guys that was a very, very high draft pick. He is a guy whose stock went up exponentially by the job that he did at the NFL Combine. And so, especially now that we have a couple of NCAA games under our belt, you know that stocks are rising and falling with any of the 12-game sample size that most of these college teams have. And so I've been keeping up with Mel Kiper's draft board, his big board. And as of right now, he has the number one player on the draft big board. And again, you know this is going to change a lot. He's got Sam Darnold,
yeah.
The quarterback at USC, who is awesome. Number two?
If it's not a quarterback, I'd say Derwin James from Florida State.
Nope. We are going to see him Saturday.
Josh Rosen. I said if it's not a quarterback.
He has Josh Rosen
James.
Number two.
Yeah. Both in Los Angeles.
So clearly, there is a chance that we will see the number one draft pick in in the NFL draft.
Yes.
On Saturday.
Yes.
There's, a great chance.
And
that you could see him.
That is a huge reason to go to the game. You are going to see a guy, without a doubt, who is going to be selected in the top five of the NFL draft.
I would say the only other ones I've seen, I think I saw Manning, and then I saw Eli.
Yeah,
they're both number one picks.
I saw both of those.
I wonder if there was anybody that was a number one draft pick that I ever saw before they were the number one draft pick.
Was Myles Garrett at A&M when we saw A&M and Ole Miss?
Yep.
Myles Garrett. Yeah,
there's a good one.
Yeah, we saw Myles Garrett.
So we saw Myles Garrett.
We saw Myles Garrett, Mike Evans, and Laquon Treadwell, and Robert Kimdichie, and all the Laramie Tunsil.
Yeah,
we saw all those guys.
Yeah, we did see a lot of guys.
Think of who else?
Back in the day, I went to a Nebraska-Texas Big 12 championship game. Maybe I saw like Orlando Pace or somebody in that.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, you just never know.
Well,
that was
Ohio State, but.
Oh, yeah.
That was Ohio State.
Who did I say?
You said Nebraska.
Nebraska, right. Yeah.
They weren't in the same conference at the time.
No, you're right. Who else? I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, it's a...
But he could be the number one pick in the draft.
Yeah.
Is the point. The rest of the top five are Josh Allen from Wyoming, another quarterback. Saquon Barkley from Penn State, number four. Derwin James, the safety from Florida State, who... Roser mentioned earlier, number five. I'll give you the rest of the top 10.
There was a great story I read on Derwin James yesterday.
Oh, yeah?
It's just, I mean, like, Florida State, like, they rave about him. Like,
great kid.
No, but he is a freak. Like, he is a freak. They're like, he has the burst of Devontae Freeman, you know, who also played at Florida State. Like, he's got the power. He's got the ability, the agility of, like, Jalen Ramsey, and he... They're like, he is a 6'3", 215-pound safety who can play defensive, who's strong enough to play defensive end sometimes.
So the top 10 were Sam Darnold from USC, Josh Rosen from UCLA, Josh Allen from Wyoming, Saquon Barkley from Penn State, number 5, Derwin James, the safety from Florida State, number 6, Harold Landry, the linebacker at Boston College, number 7, Calvin Ridley, wide receiver, Bama, number 8, Minka Fitzpatrick, defensive back, Bama, number 9, Arden Key, who is a linebacker at LSU, and then number 10, Christian Wilkins, who is a defensive lineman from Clemson, who that will be fun to see if he can chase down old Lamar Jackson.
That will be fun.
On Saturday night. So, anyways, that's a quick look at Mel Kiper's big board.
All the picks I've seen on that game are most people, are a lot of people at least I've seen, like, not like friends or anything, but people I've seen that are, that, you know, really cover college football. A lot of them are on Louisville this weekend.
Home team
catching points on a Saturday night.
Home team night. Got the best player on the field, possibly.
Yeah.
All right. Yeah. Number five. Free Zeebo. It happened. He's a free man. Zeebo, who was arrested on marijuana possession and resisting arrest earlier last month in Los Angeles, was sentenced to community service. He entered a no contest and avoided jail time. 150 hours of community service. His initial arrest on suspicion of marijuana with intent to sell is a felony. Instead, the prosecutors charged him with a misdemeanor drug possession. And so he is, he was also accused of resisting arrest and obstruction of justice. He was told that he needs to stay away from all drug dealers and not be in the vicinity for a year. And in fact, they told him that he can petition the court for charges to be vacated if he stays out of trouble for a year. So keep it clean for a year, Zeebo.
Got off on this one.
Right, for sure. Number four, the top 10 came out in that SI list that we talked about yesterday.
Yeah.
That they're counting down, as they and ESPN are both counting down, the best players in the NBA. Number 10 was Draymond Green. Number 9 was Giannis Antetokounmpo, the Greek Freak. Number 8, Anthony Davis. Number 7, Chris Paul. Number 6 was Russell Westbrook. Number 5, James Harden. Number 4, Kawhi Leonard. Number 3, Steph Curry. Number 2, Kevin Durant. And number 1, LeBron James. And I will say this, rather than getting into some big arguments about where they are numbered, there is not one guy on that list that if you flippantly said he's a top 10 player in the league, that I would go, what the hell are you talking about? So that's when I know I'm fine with it, right? You wanna switch around the orders. If you'd rather have Westbrook than Curry, or you'd rather have whatever, fine. You can swap around whatever you want to swap around. But there is nobody on that list that if somebody said to me he's a top 10 player in the league, that I would go, what, are you crazy?
Yeah, and if there are one or two guys, like I said yesterday about John Wall, if you know you wanted to put him in the top 10, like I would not argue that at all.
Well, the other one is,
if you
wanted
to put Paul George in the top 10, I'm not going to argue that at all.
And there are people that would go, Draymond Green's a top 10. Like, dude, if somebody told me they think Draymond Green's a top 10 player in the league, me personally, I don't react a bit. I'm like, okay. Dude, I saw Draymond Green get a freaking triple-double without points in my face at FedEx Forum. This is one of the most unbelievable.
No, he's awesome.
Draymond Green put on one of the greatest basketball performances I've ever seen in my life.
Yep.
Dude had 10 steals. Like, he totally dominated a basketball game.
Without scoring.
A triple-double without points.
You know who the guys who usually dominate the games without scoring are? They're big men who can just stand by the rim and block everybody's shot. Like, Dikembe Mutombo could dominate a game without scoring the basketball. There are a lot of guys. There are bigger guys who can do that who block shots. He's not the dude sitting there blocking five shots a game.
Listen, and nobody does that.
No.
What he did. What he did and what I witnessed. Because here's the thing. It was steals. The guy that gets the steals is not the guy that gets the rebounds.
Yeah.
The guy that gets the blocks is the guy that gets the rebounds.
Yeah.
This dude got the rebounds and he got the steal. Like, it's impossible. So he's an amazing basketball player for sure. But anyway, that was the top 10 that they came out with. Number 3. The college games and the lines, we've been keeping up with these as the week goes on, and we will see if there is any movement of the games that we have chronicled throughout the week so far. The first one is the Memphis-UCLA game. Now, a couple of places for the first time this week, including Five Dimes, is one of the big books for the very, very serious gamblers. Five Dimes has got that at 2.5 now. They moved down. And I will tell you that a lot of people follow the Five Dimes line. Them and Pinnacle are the two big ones that are usually followed. And so they are the first that I see that have put that down at 2.5. And I will tell you that if they're at 2.5, that a lot of people will follow.
Yeah.
Because the five dimes and the pinnacle lines are the two that a lot mimic. Clemson-Louisville is still sitting at 3 points. So that one, that's just three, and it's not moving at all. The Florida line keeps going down.
It does. It's opened at nine?
Yeah, it's now 4.5.
Wow.
Over Tennessee. And so that just seems like one you want to just keep on waiting on, right?
Yeah.
On the flip side, the LSU one keeps going up. It's now at 7.5. So if you really like Mississippi State catching over 7, I mean, it's a night game in Starkville. And
State, I mean, they haven't played anybody yet, but they've blown both teams out. They blew out Louisiana Tech and blew out, what is it, Charleston.
And I like their quarterback, man.
Yeah, they do have a good quarterback. That LSU defense has been awesome so far, so we'll see.
And it's also like, you know, you're over a touchdown favorite on the road in the SEC in a night game. You just seen so many goofy things happen.
Well, in State, I think Mullen's only beaten LSU once, but like the last couple of years, they've all been close games.
Yeah, they've had their chances over the course of the last couple of years for sure. Vanderbilt is still a 3.5-point underdog to Kansas State, and the other line that is really going down is the USC-Texas game, which at one point when we first talked about it, it was like 17.5. It is now to 15.5 for USC against Texas this weekend. So, quick look at those. Number two, the best NFL games. Well, we said that there is that game going on tonight between the Bengals and the Texans, which is, because Deshaun Watson is playing, it will be of great interest to me.
He's the main reason to watch this game is to see how he plays.
For sure. And it looks like it looks like Cincinnati is a 6-point favorite over Houston. They need Deshaun Watson because their offensive line isn't any good either. We know Houston's supposed to have a really good defense, and I think they will have a really good defense. They ran into a problem against Jacksonville last weekend, and I am not so sure that we're not going to look up and Jacksonville's defense is legitimately really good.
Yeah, that was kind of the talk. The other part
it might
of
be
it.
Really good.
I mean, yeah.
This is two really bad offensive lines going up against each other
thing,
tonight,
man,
though.
Yeah, it is. And there's the thing about Watson, though. Like, I think he's going to be really good. I do think he's going to be really good, but he didn't have to do all this in college.
No.
He didn't have to drop back and read the field. Like, he didn't have to do that in college. Like, that's not how Clemson, like, ran all their stuff. I mean, it was all – and that's how a lot of college football is today. You know, it's a simple read. It's like one read and that's it.
Yeah,
he didn't have to do a ton of that.
I think he was better than what you're giving him credit for as a drop-back guy.
No, he
was not a race-around guy all the time.
No, but like
– I read the defenses against Alabama, for God's sake.
But I could still see this being, you know – I don't know. I took the under on Houston to open the season, so I'm not just totally sold. I just don't think they're going to be.
I'm a Watson fan. Here's what I know.
I do. I think Deshaun Watson's going to be really good. It's his first ever start, so I'm not expecting.
Geno Atkins versus that Houston offensive line could be a massive problem, and likewise, Clowney and Watt could be a massive problem on the other side. So, just take the under.
Yeah,
it's 38. How are these teams getting 5 touchdowns against each other?
Yeah,
I find it hard to believe considering what they looked like last week. The Jacksonville-Tennessee game actually became a fun one this weekend.
Yeah, it
because
did.
Of the way that
yes.
And like there's a legit shot that like a lot of people were loving the Titans going into this year. Like they could absolutely start 0-2 and take a division loss against a team that everybody thought they were going to be better than.
Yeah.
If they go and lose at Jacksonville, that will not shock me at all this weekend.
No.
And then they start 0-2. You know what I mean?
And then it's a I saw
you're not in a great spot.
I saw we'll talk probably more about the NFL
tomorrow
too, as far as the teams that could start 0-2 who had, you know, playoff aspirations to start the season.
New Orleans and New England, really, really good game this weekend. Kansas City and Philly is a really good game.
Is New Orleans and New England a really good game?
Yes, considering because of what happened against New Orleans.
True, because New England's defense looks terrible, and you have a feeling, and Minnesota has a good defense, so you kind of feel like it's
bro,
New
do you
Orleans.
See what they made Alex Smith look like?
Yeah, New Orleans home
it's
opener.
It's Drew Brees, and it's in the Superdome?
It is something with New England, though. Like, two of the biggest losses they've taken in the last couple of years, both of them have come to Kansas City.
Then we got Philadelphia and Kansas City. That's a pretty good one after week one. Minnesota and Pittsburgh is really good. Minnesota-Pittsburgh is really good. And then you're going to have some duds throughout here. But we have not seen Miami and Jay Cutler. We have not seen Tampa Bay. So those have some interest just because it's the first time we're going to get to see the Bucs, who were featured on Hard Knocks. First time we're going to see the Dolphins. The Bucs play the Bears. The Dolphins play the Chargers. Jets-Oakland is terrible. Rams hosting Washington now got way more fun. So I actually like, because of the way week one played out and some of these teams that we thought would suck didn't suck,
yeah,
like Jacksonville, now they play a home game against a team you would have marked it down a loss, right? You would have just said, and the Redskins could drop to 0-2 if they get beat by the Rams over the weekend. So we're going to find out, was the Rams thing just totally about the Colts being a piece of crap, or maybe the Rams are going to be pretty good?
Well, and he's been under Jay Gruden the last couple of years. They're the Rams coach, McVay. He was the Redskins offensive coordinator from 14 to 16.
And then, of course, the Sunday night game is awesome, which is a rematch of the NFC Championship, and that is Atlanta-Green Bay. That is awesome.
Yeah, it is.
And so you have those two teams going at it. So there's a quick look ahead, and we'll talk more about the NFL games tomorrow. And number one, Memphis Madness is coming back. Saw this announcement yesterday for the college basketball team. There's just been no buzz. There just hasn't about the upcoming college basketball season. I saw the press release, and it said, like, I was like, do I even know anybody on the team anymore? And it said, come see junior college All-Americans Kareem Bruton and Kevon Davenport. Is that right?
Yeah.
Kevon?
Jeremiah Martin's the guy to promote. I mean, he's been on the team the last 2 years.
Yeah, well, I mean, no, that's what they mentioned, though, in the, like, the thing. Hey, there are two first-team JUCO All-Americans that are going to be there.
Yeah.
That's, and then I Heart Memphis.
Yeah, which, Hit the Quan, which was popular like 3 years ago, whatever it was.
A great song, though. I mean, I'd hit the Quan.
I'll hit the Quan.
And then Gabrielle Nicole. I'm unfamiliar with her.
I don't know who that is. I would say...
they said they're going to charge $5.
Yeah, that's the thing. When I heard that they were bringing Memphis Madness back, I was like, I mean, okay, there's not going to really be anybody there. Like,
you should do it in El Marone.
I'm like, maybe they could get 2,000 people there, 2,000-3,000, maybe. I was like,
they should do it in El Marone. I'm serious.
No. I've heard a lot of people say that. But then when I heard, like, and tickets will go on sale starting whenever, and tickets, they're $5 a piece, and I was like, what? I was like, you're going to get, like, 300 people in there to 500. Like, it's going to be... But what, I mean, they do what they want to do. I mean, it's their choice.
Listen, the last Josh one.
Yeah.
It was not Memphis Madness. Yeah. It was Memphis Sadness.
It was Memphis Sadness.
And nobody was there.
And I guess part
of the problem with that was, you know, all the players could meet the fans one-on-one because it was equivalent.
Yeah.
I mean, there were more players there than there were fans that were there. You know, you did wonder, right? Like, yeah. Remember that whole story? Like, dude, if you're Joe Jackson, when you came in here, there was 18,500 people in here. And now your senior year, there is literally nobody here.
Yeah.
Like, you could, that the last Pastner March Madness that they did, I could have said at the door, we are giving away boxes of anthrax, and there would not have been less people. This is going to be an absolute debacle.
It is.
And nobody has any sense to say.
I don't know how anybody.
No, you got to wait on. You got to wait to bring this back, dude. The whole thing is, you want to do it for recruits. This is not going to impress anybody. It's going to be the opposite.
No, this is not going to impress recruits.
No,
people, this is not going to.
It's just not.
You know what will impress? You know what could impress recruits? The Saturday's football game against UCLA.
Yes,
bring recruits there,
and they are.
Yes.
They'll
have
a bunch.
They will have a bunch of recruits there. That could impress them.
But do not. Don't do this.
I would honestly say. I don't know if they'll announce the numbers. I will honestly tell. I mean, I would bet Memphis Madness, charging $5, I would bet there's 500 people there.
I would normally say, oh, go to hell. But I just have no gauge.
They will not have more than 1,000 people in there for that.
I will tell you this. And the problem is the people that do want to go, those people are hardcores, which the hardcores, you know what they are? They're old.
Yes.
And if I told them that IR Memphis was playing in their backyard, they wouldn't raise their blind. So they don't care.
Well, the other thing
it's weird. The people that like really would go to support the Tigers, thick and thin, no matter what, you could do anything, and they're going to show up for you, right? Those people are old.
I doubt.
Young people? Those are the people that would care about IHeart Memphis.
My mom's a season ticket holder. She's not going to go. She's a season ticket holder for Tigers basketball. She's not going to go. She will not go to Memphis Madness. Here's the thing. It's a Thursday night.
What?
Memphis Madness is on Thursday night because the Grizzlies open against the Pelicans the night after on Friday.
Oh, jeez.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah. So it's you're talking about a Thursday night. Like, you may be able
and
to get...
And the opening night would be a sellout at Memphis, yeah. For the Grizzlies.
The only thing I would say where they could get some people in there if they're charging $5 to get in, the only way is if they come to an agreement with FedEx Forum and the Grizzlies that, hey, can we charge $2 beers?
I don't think... On a Thursday night, I don't think so.
No, that's what it'll be tough.
Right?
It'll be tougher on a Thursday night.
You and I would... Well,
on Friday night, that is how you
but
would
But you
got to
think about us.
There.
If you told me it's $2 beers on a Friday night, I'm in.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
But I ain't
especially
I can't.
FedEx Forum got big beers.
But I'm saying I can't on a Thursday night.
Yeah.
I won't feel like hell for Friday.
Well, and we got the Grizzlies home opener Friday,
right,
which like we have to be there.
Yeah, for sure.
We have to go.
Oh, well. So I don't know, man. I wanted to be, you know, I want to be excited for them, but I fear that, I don't know. If I was in that meeting over at Memphis, I'd have been like, no, guys, don't do this. Don't do this. Don't do this. Not now. You got to be more, and yeah. You got to have your finger on the pulse a little bit more than this deal.
Okay, no, it's not the Grizzlies' home opener. It's their preseason finale is the next.
Oh,
that's what it is, which is also against the Pelicans.
Oh, it is?
I believe so. I believe it's also against the Pelicans.
All right, this is going to do it for 10 Things Today. Thanks for listening to today's podcast. One other quick thing I do want to remind you is we were just talking about Grizzlies tickets. You can get the Power Packs. Right now, those are available. They've got the 6, 12, and 22 game packs. And go to Grizzlies.com or call 888-HOOP. But Grizzlies.com got all the information there, and they show you the different power packs. And that is your best way. If you don't want to make the entire investment for season tickets this upcoming year, you can still get to go see the Warriors game or the Cavs game or both of those games by getting involved with those power packs and getting partial season tickets. And you also get good perks when you have those too. 888-HOOP or Grizzlies.com. We will talk to you tomorrow.